My name is Dr. King, and I'm a professor of biology at Baylor University, and we're going to talk a little bit about life in rivers and streams today. First, just a little bit about me. I was raised in Portland, Oregon, which is a place with many rivers and streams, and spending a lot of time outdoors with my father and doing a lot of fly fishing was one of the things that really inspired me to become an aquatic scientist. And while I didn't necessarily know for sure that there were opportunities like this for a career, I certainly was interested in biology from a young age, and I was a biology major at a small liberal arts college called Harding University in Arkansas. From there, I applied to graduate school and went and received a master's and a PhD at Duke University in North Carolina in ecology, specifically aquatic ecology. From there, I received a little more training at the Smithsonian Environmental Research Center in Maryland, where I ran up and down Chesapeake Bay in boats chasing blue crabs and striped bass, which was a very fun experience, which ultimately led me to Baylor University, where I am now a professor of biology. I teach courses and I conduct research, particularly on streams and rivers. Today, we're going to address a couple of questions. First is, what are some of the common types of organisms found in rivers and streams, and where in a river or stream can you find these organisms? Secondly, do we affect the diversity and abundance of these organisms, and if so, in what way? Well, let's start by talking about, well, what is a stream? What defines a stream? Well, flowing water is really the main characteristic that separates streams from other types of freshwater habitats. Here I'm showing you a small stream in Alaska. This is actually one of my research sites on the Kenai Peninsula. This is what we call a headwater stream. It's steep, high gradient, and quite small. We could actually jump across this stream. Later in the season, when the grasses begin to grow, you won't even be able to see the stream because it'll be covered completely by overhanging vegetation. This is probably the most common type of stream, but often these go unnoticed. Well, what's the difference between a stream and a river? Well, there isn't a great definition, and once streams become large enough to where there's no canopy above them, and you can float recreational boats, for example, canoes, kayaks, oftentimes we call those small rivers. In this case, you can wade across this stream, but you can also float it in a kayak. Definitively, a large river is one where large motorboats and even ships can travel. Here's an example of the Columbia River near where I grew up in Portland, Oregon, one of the largest rivers in North America. Now, I bet most of you didn't realize that rivers and streams have anatomy. Well, I'm going to teach you a little bit about the anatomy and how this anatomy is critical for the types of organisms that you find in streams. This shallow, fast-moving habitat is what are called riffles. They're characterized by turbulent water. You can see the surface of the water is quite broken. If you were to wade out there, it might be hard to stand up because the water is moving so quickly. Just as an aside, I took this image from one of my study sites with a drone. So we aquatic biologists get to have fun with toys like drones, and this is exactly how I got this image. From here, this is called a run. What differentiates the run from other types of habitats is that it's deeper and faster than a pool, but it lacks the broken surface water and shallow habitats that you see in riffles. Farther downstream, these are pool habitats. Water is slow moving and tends to be the deepest part of a stream. And then a habitat we won't talk much about, but also it's called a glide. This is shallow but slow moving habitat that usually precedes a riffle, just before the river begins to drop into a riffle habitat. For purposes of this talk today, I'm going to focus primarily on just riffles and pools, as these are the two most distinct habitats in rivers and streams. So riffles, we talked about some of the key aspects of it. They're very turbulent, well mixed with the atmosphere. What does that mean? Well, that basically means that because of that turbulence, air is getting mixed in with the water, and it continues to reoxygenate the water. And there are certain types of organisms in streams that require very high levels of oxygen. We also call this habitat erosional, as in fine sediment and other particles tend to erode from that habitat and move downstream. And what's left behind are big, coarse, rocky substrates. Pools, on the other hand, are deep, slow-moving water, non-turbulent, and tend not to be well mixed with the atmosphere, particularly if they're a long distance away from a riffle. At the bottom of pools, we find fine sediment and sand, and that's why we call these depositional habitats. These two contrasting habitats are really important because there's certain organisms that are going to, that have evolved to actually utilize these habitats, and their bodies will actually translate into this particular habitat. So, what are some of the common types of organisms in rivers and streams? Well, we're going to focus primarily on two groups of organisms today, partly because I think they're the coolest of all, but they're also the most diverse in terms of animal life in streams. And the first is aquatic macroinvertebrates, especially aquatic insects. The second are fish. There are an amazing number of diversity of fishes that have evolved specifically in stream habitats, including these beautiful darters that I'm showing you here. Now, among the aquatic insects, probably the crown jewel of all aquatic insects, the one that most ecologists find most interesting to study, are mayflies. Mayflies are very primitive organisms. They're some of the oldest insects on Earth, and they also have some very interesting characteristics. First of all, the name Ephemeroptera, which is the order name, means short-lived wing. So short-lived wing translates Ephemeroptera. Most mayfly species are found in streams and rivers and require very high water quality. In fact, dissolved oxygen is extremely critical for these. Immature mayflies are called nymphs. They molt many times as they grow, sometimes as many as 40 times. Very small species of mayflies may live only a few weeks as a nymph, whereas other larger-bodied ones may live as long as 2 years underwater. Mayflies actually hatch out of their nymphal skin and become a winged adult. So they're spending their virtually most of their adult lives underwater as a nymph, growing to finally mature and emerge as an adult insect. Once they emerge, their purpose in life is to simply find a mate, lay fertilized eggs, and die, and the life cycle continues. So short-lived wing relates to the fact that they don't live very long out of the water. Getting back to form follows function, we talked about habitats and how organisms' morphology may relate to that habitat. Well, if you look at this particular mayfly, this nymph, you may notice some interesting characteristics. This guy is specifically adapted to live in fast-moving riffle habitat. In fact, its habit, its body morphology is classified as a clinger. So has a wide, flat body, broad, strong legs, and allows it to cling very tightly in fast velocity water. It's also really flattened, dorsoventrally compressed, so it gets very keeps its body very closely oppressed to rocks. This particular species of mayfly scrapes and grazes on microscopic algae. This is also called biofilms or periphyton. And any of you who have waded in a mountain stream probably have noticed at times that rocks can be quite slippery. And it's these biofilms that make the rocks slippery. And these guys graze on that particular habitat. I'll show you a very brief video where you can see those are its gills. Because this mayfly is in a still water situation right now, as this as it was being filmed, the mayfly is needing oxygen, and so will actually begin to move the water across its gills by flapping. Let's contrast this mayfly with this long cylindrical body, short, stout legs. What do you think this particular mayfly is adapted? What type of habitat do you think it's adapted to live in? Well, those forelegs are a lot like an animal that would like to dig or burrow. And in fact, that is what these guys do. This is a burrowing mayfly nymph, and its habitat are pools and deep, slow channels of large rivers. It has evolved to live in depositional habitats. It actually digs a burrow, and within the burrow, it will undulate its body and move the gills to generate a current that brings clean, oxygenated water into the burrow and back out again. It also has very large gills with a lot of fine filaments because living in that type of environment makes it difficult for them to maintain oxygen. And so this is an example of a burrowing type mayfly. So contrast these two and you can see how the habitat relates directly to the morphology of these organisms. Now, why am I showing you what looks like a Doppler radar event of a thunderstorm or something else? Well, this is in fact not a thunderstorm. This is an emergence of mayflies from the Mississippi River near La Crosse, Wisconsin. Mayflies, while they don't all emerge in May, they do in some parts of the country, especially these large ones, and hence the name mayfly. And they can emerge in such large numbers that they are actually detected on Doppler radar. This is the species of mayfly that's emerging here. It's called Hexagenia lambata. And here's an example of a mass emergence of them from a river. Mayflies can be really prolific and play a very important role in food webs in rivers. Another type of aquatic insect that I think you guys will find really neat and interesting is called a caddisfly or Trichoptera. Trichoptera means hairy wing, and these are wings covered in tiny hairs called trichia. The adult caddisfly looks a lot like a small moth, but it has a tent-shaped wing that covers its abdomen. Unlike mayflies, they have three life stages, a larva, a pupa, and an adult, and hence they're similar to butterflies, which go through those same type of stages. Like mayflies, they need clean water, but unlike mayflies, many of them build really cool portable cases. These serve as protection, and they also help weight the caddisfly down to help keep them on the bottom. Here are some examples of some of the amazing cases that these caddisflies can build. Each species of caddisfly typically builds a case that's very specific to that species. Here, for example, is one that actually uses snail shells, old snail shells that it finds on the stream bottom. The one in the middle uses plant material to make a very tubular shaped case. Whereas this one on the bottom in the right-hand corner uses fine sand grains to make a case. Caddisflies are so adept at building cases that many have recognized them as art and even put them to work building cases out of precious metals and jewels. Here's an example of a caddisfly being pulled out of a case and then was allowed to reconstruct its own case using gold flecks, pearls, and other types of precious metals and jewels. Here's a GIF image showing this caddisfly taking pieces of gold, essentially gluing these pieces together using silk that it secretes from its mouth parts. And here's some other examples of this amazing caddisfly art. Is pretty amazing to me. So these are some of the most amazing artists in the animal world. If you're interested in more of this, there's a link. Let's move on to talk a little bit about stream fishes. Stream fishes are unique in that they tend to have really streamlined body shape. Again, this is to reduce drag in moving water so that they can inhabit some of the habitats, for example, riffles. Many of them live on the bottom and don't swim around very much. These fish are mostly found in riffles, and they lack certain features such as a swim bladder because they don't want to be buoyant. They want to sink to the bottom, and so that allows them to stay in that habitat. Fish that are typically found in pools are ones that you're used to seeing more typically in lakes, for example, sunfish. Here's some examples of other riffle-dwelling fish species. There are four different families. These are entirely unrelated fish, but do you see some similarities? Again, they have elongated, kind of cylindrical bodies. Some of them have large pectoral fins that allow them to kind of hold on to the bottom. But clearly the cylindrical streamlined shape is something that is a distinct advantage for fishes that live in stream habitats. I've given you a little bit of a taste of the diversity of organisms that are common in streams. But how do we affect this diversity? It turns out that a lot of these organisms are quite sensitive. And it turns out that activities on the watershed are the most important activities that affect stream life. So for example, runoff from housing communities, industry, and agricultural areas pollute streams and can kill sensitive species such as mayflies. The types and abundance of organisms in a stream can tell us a lot about the stream health and potentially things on the watershed that are going on that could be a problem. In fact, they're so sensitive to certain types of pollution that they're used worldwide as indicators. We actually calculate certain indices that provide a score of how healthy a stream is simply by the organisms that are there. And for this reason, much of my research has been dedicated to identifying critical levels of pollution and using stream organisms as indicators of that pollution. And here's an example of a couple of my students collecting benthic macroinvertebrates from a stream. And this is a large part of what I do. So to wrap up, I appreciate your attention and I invite you to ask any questions if you have any.
How long have mayflies lived for?
Mayflies have been around for hundreds of millions of years, probably on the order of 250 to 300 million years ago. They are probably living aquatic insect, and there are only a couple of other insect species that are much older. So,
are these streamlined riffle fish related to catfish?
Some of them are. One of them, called a mad tom, and then one of the pictures that I just showed you, is indeed a catfish. And so certain catfish have adapted to that sort of riffle habitat. And those mad toms are actually quite small. They don't get to be nearly the size of their larger cousins that you typically find in big rivers and lakes.
Dr. King, could you please tell us a little bit more about your education?
As an undergraduate, I studied biology, and an undergraduate degree in biology is really a good foundational degree if you're interested in a wide range of sciences. For me, it allowed me to get into a graduate program at Duke University that was about managing water resources. And then from there, I went to a doctoral program that was more specifically about ecology. And I spent my PhD work was done, like I mentioned, at Duke, where I did a dissertation on the Everglades. I spent most of my time in South Florida studying the effects of phosphorus enrichment on the Everglades and determining critical levels of pollution in that sensitive environment.
How does pollution impact streams and rivers?
It impacts it in a lot of different ways, and it really depends on the type of pollution. And so let's focus on a couple of different types of pollution. For one, many people don't think of it this way, but sedimentation, that is erosion from the landscape that puts fine sediment into streams, is one of the most significant forms of pollution. It accumulates in those riffle habitats, and it fills up the spaces between those rocks where all those unique organisms such as mayflies and those streamlined fishes live. And so they lose that habitat, and hence we lose a lot of different species because of sediment. Another form of pollution is nutrient enrichment. And nutrients include nitrogen and phosphorus from fertilizers that we put on our lawns or from wastewater treatment discharges. And these nutrients stimulate certain types of algae to grow. And when algae begins to grow prolifically, it can start to have significant impacts on the dissolved oxygen levels in streams. And so during certain times when a big algal bloom occurs, these are periods where we often see a lot of stream organisms die because the oxygen levels become too low. So those are two examples how pollution from activities on the watershed affects streams.
Are the banded sculpin related to gibi that live in the St. Lawrence?
I'm not sure. But there are fishes, there are sculpins in the St. Lawrence, and so I would not be surprised if it is closely related. Perhaps, maybe, was it goby? Is that what they were asking?
Goby, yes.
So there's a No, they're not technically closely related, but gobies, you may be referring to round gobies, which are invasive in the Great Lakes. So, but yes, they have a similar appearance and they live on the bottom like that, exactly.
Are mayflies important to the ecosystem? And if so, why?
They are very important to the ecosystem because they're one of the most diverse aquatic insects. And so all of the different species of mayflies have different functions. Some of them occupy certain habitats and eat certain types of food. And because of that, they become food for other organisms, particularly fish and birds. When they emerge, oftentimes birds that live around streams benefit tremendously. So they are what we call a link in the food web, a critical link in the food web. And by transferring energy from lower levels like algae and eating leaf litter, they make a significant impact on food webs. And for organisms that we really care about in terms of recreation, like birding or fishing.
What is the salary range of a biologist marine?
It depends on the type of biologist. So, for example, like a fisheries biologist working for the state, looking somewhere between $50,000 to $75,000 a year. If you work as a professor, professors typically start somewhere around that same range, but their salaries can continue to increase over time. So, a typical good starting salary for biologists are probably somewhere in the $50,000 to $75,000 range.
Do aquatic biologists study fish in the ocean?
Sure. There's typically, we call those folks marine biologists, but absolutely, aquatic biologists do definitely study fish in the ocean. And I actually happen to study fish that live in the ocean, but they come back to streams to spawn, and those are called salmon. So I spent a lot of time in Alaska studying juvenile life stages of salmon and how the landscape affects their habitat. But they're truly a fish that lives most of its life in the ocean. So I guess I kind of do as well.
Do you get a scuba dive?
A lot of my colleagues scuba dive, and I don't scuba dive because I have problems with my ears, actually, diving too deeply. So I have not done a lot of scuba diving, but some people definitely do. In fact, people scuba dive in rivers and will dive down and do fish surveys that way.
Are there different types of marine biologists that do different kind of work?
Yes, marine biology is a huge field, really. Oftentimes people think of marine biology as being about dolphins and whales primarily, but really marine biologists spend a lot of time studying, for example, fish stocks, trying to understand how fisheries impact fish stocks. Or I have colleagues who study coral reefs. They're marine biologists. So really anybody who's studying life in salt water is a marine biologist. And so they're really diverse in terms of what they do.
Can mayflies kill crops? Like when you get a plague of locusts?
It would seem like that would potentially be a problem, but mayflies do not feed as adults. They live only to mate and lay the eggs and die. And so when you see a huge population, a huge emergence of mayflies like that, they're not going to feed on anything. The question then might be, well, why are so many of them emerging all at once like that? And it's a defense mechanism, because there's so many of them. Predators, namely birds, can only eat so many of them. They actually get satiated by eating so many of the mayflies that it ensures that a lot of the mayflies are going to be able to reproduce and lay their eggs. So it's a really interesting evolutionary adaptation to actually satiate predators so that some of them can survive and reproduce.
We had a debate going on. Fishes, somebody said it wasn't a real word.
Oh, okay. Well, fish refers to, in general, when we're talking about, like you can have a basket full of fish, large numbers of them, or it could be singular about one fish. But fishes refers to multiple species of fish. So when someone says fishes, they are referring to multiple species. So fishes is a word. In fact, if you look up, if you look for a book on identifying fish, they'll actually be called, for example, the fishes of Oklahoma or fishes of Alabama, because it's a book about a lot of different species of fish.
Dr. King, thank you so very much for sharing the information and sharing your time with us. Appreciate it. Have a great day, everybody. Thank you for participating.